chest.
Praise the Lord, Renew Church. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Amen?
Amen.
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 The psalmist said, I was glad when they said unto me, let us enter into the house of the Lord. And we are so happy that you are here on behalf of our senior pastor, Pastor Checkerz, and his lovely wife, Sister Nicole. We are glad that you are here. And for those of you who are joining with us online, we're glad that you are joining with us. Be sure to hit the like button, the share button, the heart button, and please connect with us. You have an opportunity to connect with us in person. We'd love to have you here in person, or you can connect with a connect group as well online. If you're here in the sanctuary, please stand on your feet as we go before the Lord in prayer and we enter into a time of worship. Let us bow our heads. Father, I just thank you for this opportunity to come before you and worship, oh God. We thank you for this resurrection day, oh God, as we celebrate your love, your kindness, your mercy, your grace, how you left heaven and you came to earth to redeem your people, O God. And may this worship experience glorify your name, O God. And we love you and we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. This is your call to worship.
Amen.
All right, y'all ready to stand up and sing on this glorious day?
Dry. Drink of the water, come and thirst no more. Come all you sinners, come find his mercy. Come to the table, he will satisfy. Taste of his goodness, find what you're looking for.
So loved the world that he gave us, his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever.
Bring all your failures, bring your addictions, come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is where
so loved the world that he gave us, his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever.
The power of hell's been defeated.
The power of hell forever defeated.
Now
it is well. I'm walking in freedom for God so loved. God so loved the world.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, for the wonders of his love.
Praise God,
praise God,
praise God. So love.
Jesus is waiting. God so loved the world.
Amen. Amen.
Woo!
Thank you, Lord.
Glory of the risen King Jesus.
You know that we serve a God magnify your name. Woo. Because it's Resurrection Day, the day that you rose up on the third day to Woo. Give us eternal life, that we may live for you. We thank you. We magnify you. We praise you. We glorify you, because without you we'll be nothing. Thank you for saving us. Thank you for delivering us. Thank you for setting us free. Thank you for making us overcomers. Thank you in the name of Jesus. We give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
Woo, amen.
Glory. Glory.
All right, listen, for just a moment, you can be seated. We are continuing in worship, and we're going to come back and sing some more. But right now, in the midst of this worship, on this Resurrection Sunday, there is no greater honor than to baptize people, symbolizing that they have died to their old way of life and been resurrected to a new life in Christ. So we have two baptisms to celebrate this morning. Come on, let's thank the Lord for the work that he's doing in the lives of several people. And so this is Adrian. Adrian actually began attending our church off and on in 2020, and she's been here and then really started plugging in recently and being committed and coming. And in January, she arrived at a place where she realized that she needed to surrender her heart and her life to the Lord. And so today, she wants to go public with that faith and let people know that she is unashamed to have committed her life to Christ. So Adrian, has there ever been a time in your life where you've accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior? Well, based on your profession of faith, my sister, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. All right, and I'm going to move out of the way. We're not done, but we have one more baptism. And you know, as we do things here, whoever is discipling someone, whether that's their own children or someone else, we give them the opportunity to baptize the person they're discipling. And so this is a family affair here, so we're going to welcome the Gaddy family into the baptistry waters.
So this is Levi. Levi, we've been attending Renew for 5 years now, and he has asked many questions and we've had lots of theological discussions at home. And he made a profession of faith a couple years ago, actually, and we have been discussing baptism and the importance of it and what it means, and he hasn't been ready until just this past week. He came to me and said that he was ready to make a public profession of faith. So Levi, has there been a time when you accepted Jesus as your Savior? Based on that profession of faith, I baptize you, my son and brother, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Something to worship about. Amen. Stand back up. Woo. Amen.
Every day. Every day.
Change. Jesus, you are mine. The endless joy and perfect peace, earthly pain finally will cease. Celebrate, Jesus is alive. My sin away. Oh, happy day, I'll never be the same. Oh, happy day, you wash my sin away. Oh, happy day, I'll never be the same. No, 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 no. Forever I am changed. Wash my sin away, oh, happy day, I'll never be the same. No, 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 forever I am changed. Oh, what a glorious day, what a glorious way. You have saved me, and oh, what a glorious name, what a glorious name. Oh, I love the name, there's so much power in his name.
Oh, what a glorious name, what a glorious way. Wash my sin away, oh, happy day, I'll never be the same, oh,
happy day,
you wash my sin away, oh, happy day.
Again for the worship team, amen. The baptisms, God is so faithful today, amen. He's so faithful. I want to give you a chance to turn and greet somebody, say hello, shake a hand, give a hug, do something. Welcome to our online guests and any of our guests in house. Welcome to Renew Church. My name is Carmen, and I am over family ministries here at Renew Church. I just want to take a minute as you guys sit down and thank our volunteers for yesterday. Please clap for yesterday. It was amazing. We served over 750 people. You guys did an amazing job. It could not be done without our serve team. And the Lord is smiling for the way that you guys serve. I am so grateful for each and every one of you guys. If any of our families were here from yesterday that were at the event, raise your hand. Welcome to Renew. We're so thankful for you guys. Welcome, welcome. Thank you for joining us today. If you take a look at the screen, you'll get a chance to see some of the people serving and just all of the amazing things that took place. Not that I'm competitive or anything, but there's definitely a winner for the Easter eggs. All the people who filled Easter eggs, we had a competition with our Connect groups, and we said there were major bragging rights for the rest of the year for whoever Connect group won. So a little drum roll, please, a little drum roll. Stand up for the Sunday morning Connect group, Pastor Joey, Pastor Sabrina's group. If any of you guys are here, stand up, wave your arm. Y'all filled over 2,000 eggs just by yourself. Y'all did an amazing job. We filled over 8,000 eggs this year. And so I do not want it to be missed that every Connect group did an amazing job. Thank you so much for being the body of Christ and for reaching the community like the way we do. We are a small church, but we are mighty. Amen? Amen. And so just two last things before I go off. One is take a look in your program. There is a Connect card. Please be sure to fill it out if you have or want any information. We will follow up with you guys. And if you just want us to know who you are, write it on there. We pray over every Connect card. And then the last thing, we're going to go ahead and dismiss the children. So I want to go ahead and turn your attention to the screen. Thank you.
We love kids here at Renew. At this time, we are ready to release the kids to our new kids ministry. We have nursery through 4 years old and kindergarten through fifth grade. Our leaders are ready to take the children at this time.
Well, good morning, Renew Church. As the kids are heading out, again, just on behalf of Renew Church, I want to say welcome. We realize there are many places you could be today, but we're excited that you're here to worship with us on this Resurrection Sunday. We believe here that every Sunday is we're celebrating the resurrection, but this is a time to set aside, known as Holy Week, where it is the time when during the Passover, when on Good Friday, Jesus, of course, went to the cross and was sacrificed, but then on the third day, today, Sunday, he resurrected. As I like to say, he got up and he walked out of that tomb like a boss. And he defeated the power of the enemy once and for all. And so we're excited that you're, come on, that's a good time to thank the Lord for the victory that we have in Christ. And so I am Pastor Checkerz, and on behalf of Renew Church, welcome again. You've already been greeted, but on behalf of Renew Church to our first-time guests, Nicole and I, my wife, would love to meet you after service. We actually have a gift for you that we're going to put in your hand, and we'll have several other people helping us out because we realize we have a lot of guests today. But don't forget, before you zip out after church, to stop and see Nicole and I in the foyer, even if you have to go retrieve the kids and come back, make sure you see us because we want to just be a blessing today and put something in your hands. It is the time of the service where we worship the Lord through our giving, and here at Renew Church, we don't talk much about like tithing and things of that nature. We believe the Bible really gives us a model of generous giving. So one of our core values here at Renew is generous giving, and you've already seen the pictures of yesterday. That's just one example of how we like to connect with and love our community, and those take resources, keeping the lights on, our very meager staff that we have, all of those things. Whenever you give, that's what you're doing, is you're enabling us to continue to do the work that the Lord has called us to do in impacting our city with the upward, inward, outward, learning to love God supremely, loving ourselves rightly, and then loving others unconditionally. And so as you prepare to give, there are multiple ways you can do that. You can certainly give in person here. You can give online or text to give. All that information is also in your program. But however you give, the only ask we have is that you allow the Lord to lead you in your giving. Let's pray over our offering. Father, again, we are so grateful to gather together on this Resurrection Sunday as we celebrate the gift of your Son, Jesus. Father, without him, there is no hope. There is no promise of an eternal future. And Father, we're grateful for the way we were able just to connect with our community yesterday. And we know that that was made possible through those who faithfully support our ministry. So God, as we prepare to worship you through our giving, I pray that you would bless the giver and the gift, that you would multiply it the way you did with the fish and the loaves, God, so that many more people can hear the message of the gospel. So, Father, continue to lead us to be good stewards over that which you've entrusted to us, and we commit to give you all of the glory, the honor, and the praise that is due your name. For it is in your Son Jesus' name, the resurrected one, that we pray. And the church said, amen, amen. While they're taking up the offering, I would ask if you would turn your attention to the screens one more time.
It was Friday afternoon, and Jesus is dead. His brutalized body hanging without life on a cross dropped into a hole in the dirt. His executioners had dug the holes, prepared the place, and done their job with ruthless efficiency. This wasn't how it was supposed to be. The hope of mankind overcome by powers of hell, by the shadow of a grave. We once knew what it was like to rule and reign on the earth. We were made to live in the light, in relationship, in purpose. We were made for more than what we've come to accept as normal. Ever since the garden, Satan and his kingdom have been tightening their grip. Darkness has ruled, evil, chaos, suffering, hopelessness. We've been enslaved and crippled by the holes the enemy has been digging for us too. But instead of killing the Messiah, the cross became a catalyst for salvation. The hole that was dug to hold an instrument of shame and death was instead filled with an instrument to bring healing and new life. That's the way God is. Nothing is impossible with Him. He's always restoring, always renewing, always able to take what was meant for evil and turn it for good, to take our graves and turn them into gardens. Why? Because He never gave up on His plan. He has never given up on us. He knows what we don't, that you can't have resurrection life without death. Jesus, He died so we can have lives of purpose and power over the grave. He is not dead, He is alive. And because He lives, we can live again.
Yeah. Can we just go home now? Are you ready for the word? I want you to open your Bibles or your Bible apps to Luke chapter 24. Luke chapter 24, the final chapter of Luke's gospel. There's a lot going on here, but we're going to focus on one thing and one thing only today. And that is that He is not dead. That Jesus, again, got up on that Sunday morning very early. It says that the women arrived at the tomb, we'll see in just a moment, to find that there was no one there. I want to start just by go ahead and share with you that inside your program, if you're new or newer and you're not aware of this, there is a sermon outline for you to follow along with today's message. If you're watching online, you can download that at our site. They have provided the link, and you can also have the sermon outline. And I want to just go ahead and read the first six verses. I've titled today's message, The Implications of the Empty Tomb. It's important for us to understand that we can talk about history. A lot has happened. We learn about certain history and things as we're in school. There's things that we need to learn about history that we may not learn in school, but we learn about history even when it comes to Christological things and the Bible. But what's important for us to understand is as we learn these things, there are implications for us. And so today, I just want to focus on what are the implications for us of the empty tomb. And so in Luke's gospel, Luke was a physician. He was the doctor. And there in verse 1, he says, on the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they came to the tomb, bringing the spices they had prepared. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb. They went in, but did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were perplexed about this, suddenly two men stood by them in dazzling clothes. They were wearing their Sunday best. Verse 5, it says, so the women were terrified, and they bowed down to the ground. Why are you looking for the living among the dead? Asked the men. He is not here, but He has risen. The big idea for today's message, as I've kind of already alluded to, is the fact that Jesus rose from the dead has relevant implications for us today, for our lives even today. Satan has always wanted to discredit the resurrection of Jesus, and there's a reason why. There have been multiple attempts that Satan has used various methods to discredit the resurrection of Jesus. Why? Because the resurrection of Jesus guarantees our ultimate deliverance, and it guarantees His ultimate defeat.
Detractors have said that Jesus was never actually dead, but we know that the Roman soldiers made sure that he was dead, for if you back up and read in the Gospels, and even extra biblical resources attest to the fact that whenever someone was crucified, that the Romans were going to make sure that person was dead before they removed them from the cross. And so when they came, they would break their ankles so they could no longer lift themselves up to get oxygen, and they would suffocate. But when they came to Jesus, because he had been so mercilessly beaten already through the flogging and was there on the cross, the prophecy was fulfilled that not a bone in his body would be broken. And so there was no need to break his ankles. They said he's dead already. Well, let's just verify that he's dead. And it says they took a spear and they pierced his side, and not only blood, but water came out, signifying that he had not only was dead, but that he had been dead for quite some time. And so when they saw that, they knew he was dead. There's no question. The Romans ensured he was dead. Detractors have also said that Jesus' body was stolen. That explains why the tomb was empty. But the tomb was heavily guarded again by Roman soldiers who would have never let that happen. I think sometimes when we watch these movies that are recreated of biblical events, it does a great disservice to us. I don't have time to unpack why many of the representations in that scripture are not even reflective of the proper cultures of the Bible, but in essence, we also see a lot of weak people being portrayed as people who... I want you to think about special forces for a moment in our American military. And then I want you to imagine our Navy SEALs. And then I want you to imagine the elite guards are those who were tasked with guarding Jesus' tomb. These were not some Passovers who were looking for a free ride. They were part of this Roman army, this elite guard, and they were tasked with guarding the tomb. They never would have let anyone come in and steal Jesus' body. So we know that's out the window. Detractors have also said that the body of Jesus was never actually placed in the tomb, and that explains why his body was not there on Easter Sunday, which defies all accounts. Again, even non-biblical resources that historians have uncovered through archaeology that attest to the fact that Jesus' body was placed in the tomb on that Good Friday almost 2,000 years ago. But we, as believers, we know what really happened on Sunday. We don't have to wonder. The evidence is overwhelming. In fact, faith is a good thing. It's a necessary thing. The Bible says, without faith, it is impossible to please God. But listen to me, church, when there is facts, when there are facts and evidence to support our faith, we know that in a court of law today, Jesus would have been convicted of rising from the dead beyond any reasonable doubt. There's just too much evidence. And while I don't have time to present all of the evidence this morning, before I get into the implications, I feel it's necessary to give some evidence, because maybe you're new to this. Maybe you're like I was at 20 years old and had never been in church, never knew anything about the Bible, and someone approaches you, or you're here now and you're hearing about this for the first time. And it was a foreign concept to me. So let me just give you the evidence if your faith is not there yet. We know that Jesus rose from the dead because there were hundreds of eyewitness accounts that were recorded of the resurrected Jesus over a period of almost 7 weeks. Hundreds. The Jews tried to explain away the tomb by saying Jesus' followers stole his dead body from the tomb, knowing that they would lose their life for that very testimony, for allowing that to happen. We know that for those who are serious skeptics and need actual evidence outside of the Bible, well, let me give you some of that evidence. The Bible is not the only source that addresses the empty tomb. We've already established that he was put in the tomb, but the Toledoth Jezu was a collection of early Jewish writings that also tried to explain away the empty tomb. Not Christian resource, not the Bible, but extra-biblical resources. And then there comes the need to understand the culture of that day. If we're going to understand how we can know the evidence is there, as John Piper pointed out, Jesus' tomb was never venerated as a shrine. And you say, well, what does that mean to me? Let me explain the culture a little bit of the first century. In the first century, it was custom to set up a shrine at the site of a holy man's bones. There were at least 50 cities in that area that practiced this during Jesus' day and at that time. And since there was no such shrine for Jesus, we know that's because his bones were not in that tomb anymore. The fact that Scripture notes that women were the first to discover the empty tomb. If you understand the culture, you would understand that's why it lends credibility, because women in that time were not even allowed to give testimony to anything, but they were the ones chosen by God to give testimony that the tomb was empty and Jesus had risen. And then finally, let me just give you one more. There's no other way to explain how the cowering and panicking disciples, even Peter, who would deny that he even knew Jesus three times while Jesus was there on the cross and going to the cross, that just days later, we find these disciples proclaiming boldly the very Christ that they fled for the hills because they were afraid of what would happen to them. Now they are standing up boldly saying, "This Jesus whom you crucified has now become both Savior and Lord." The evidence is just too overwhelming. So if you still have questions, listen, we would love to talk with you about it. But make no mistake about it. As I said already, Jesus got up on that third day and he walked out of that tomb like a boss, fully alive and fully resurrected. And more importantly, fully victorious over death, hell, and the grave. So let me just say this, that any denial of the resurrection of Jesus requires ignoring the mountains of evidence that is there. And what's interesting to me, because in this age of social media, is that everybody now is a YouTube scholar. Well, I saw on YouTube. You realize that there are mountains of books in a thing called a library. And you can even get a lot of those on Kindle, but a lot of those older books that really lean back into history, where we can actually see what was going on, and mountains of people attesting to what happened. As I said earlier, if all of that evidence was presented in a court of law, there is no doubt that Jesus would be convicted of rising from the dead beyond a reasonable doubt. So what does this resurrection of Christ mean for us today? I'm not even going to labor long today. I feel like we can just get to the point. Is that all right? On your handout there, you're going to see the three things that I believe are the most important implications. Now, I'm coming at this from a perspective of us as believers, but if you're here today and you have not come to that place where you have trusted Jesus as your Savior, we're going to talk about that momentarily. But let me just start by saying that because Christ rose from the dead, our faith, us as believers, our faith is validated. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 17, the Apostle Paul wrote these words to the Christians there in Corinth. He said, "And if Christ has not been raised, then your faith is worthless. You are still in your sins." But we've already established that beyond a shadow of a doubt, that Jesus rose from the dead. So our faith is validated. The Lord of all creation took on flesh. He lived a sinless life. He died on the cross to purchase our salvation. And then he rose from the dead because he loves us. Romans 5:8 tells us it this way, that God demonstrated his love for us, that while we were yet sinners, Christ still died for us. The Bible goes on to say in Romans chapter 3, verse 23, that all have sinned. That means every human that ever walks planet Earth, past, present, and future, are sinners except for Jesus. He's the only sinless human being that ever walked. But all of us are sinners. And so that seems pretty bleak, because when you jump a few chapters over to Romans chapter 6, verse 23, it says that the wages of sin is death. But I love that conjunction clause in there, that word, but. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Our faith is validated. The implication of Jesus rising from the dead says we don't believe in some fairy tale. We don't believe in something somebody just made up for YouTube. We didn't make up some pagan false thing that, because Easter sounds like Ishtar, that somehow it's connected to the pagan goddess of fertility. I don't have time to unpack that today. Listen, everybody's a YouTube scholar, but all you got to do is pick up a book. I know Google seems easier, but sometimes you just need to pick up a book and do some actual research. The reality is people want to explain away the resurrection. But he got up, and he is alive, and because of that, our faith is validated. Because Christ rose from the dead, secondly, our hope is alive. Our hope is alive. Blessed, in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, because his great mercy, he has given us, here it is, a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Because Jesus got up, our hope is alive. It's not like we have momentary hope. It's not like we have passing hope. It's not like we're ever hopeless, because no matter, listen to me, church, no matter what you're going through in life, you always have a living hope, because Jesus Christ got up and walked out of that tomb and sits at the right hand of the Father waiting to receive his children when the time is appointed. Because Jesus rose from the dead, here's the promise. We have this inheritance waiting for us that eclipses anything that we suffer in this life. We just finished our study through the book of Philippians, where Paul was chained up in prison while he was writing these letters, the prison epistles and the letters, and he wrote this church to Philippi, and the whole thing he kept talking about was all the joy he had while he was chained and in prison suffering. The joy he had was because he understood the living hope that is found in the resurrected Jesus. That's why Paul would go on to say these words, "For I consider," in Romans chapter 8, verse 18, "I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us." So listen, if you've been here, you know we've been talking about it. But if you're new, I just feel like I need to pause and say, you might be going through hell on earth, and you might be trying everything you can to find some hope, to find some light, to find some relief. And I'm telling you, there is a void in your life that can only be filled with the resurrected Jesus. And even in the midst of our suffering, we can be like Paul and say, you know what, I'm suffering now, and I may continue to suffer until I check out of here, but there is a living hope that I have, that because Christ has resurrected, I get to go be with him. And when I get to go be with him, listen to me, there is no more pain, there is no more hatred, there is no more racism, there is no more suffering, there is no more death or mourning or pharmacies or handicapped parking spaces. None of those things will be needed in heaven, because we serve a resurrected Savior who makes all things new. As Christians, listen, we don't hope in something that is empty and something that is vain, like the things of this world that are passing away, but we hope in someone who fulfills his promises. He said, if you destroy this temple, I will raise it up in 3 days. They thought he was talking about the temple, the physical temple, the building. He said, no, I'm not talking about the building. It went right over their heads. He was talking about his body. This is the temple of God. You destroy this temple, and in 3 days, he said, I will raise it up, and he fulfilled that promise. And so we don't hope in something that is vain or passing or not promised, but we hope in the fulfilled promises of our Savior. The third thing, implication, is that because Christ rose from the dead, our future is secure. Our future is secure. I thought I was at a renewed church. I thought I was going to get a better amen right there. Our future is secure. Listen, the Bible says that there is no one that can pluck you out of the Father's hand. When you call on the name of Jesus to save you, you are signed, sealed, delivered, you're his. The Bible says you are sealed with the Holy Spirit, that a deposit has been placed on your life guaranteeing your inheritance. That means, guess what? You didn't do anything to earn it. So there's nothing you can do to lose it. And there's nothing anyone else can do to take it away from you. Your future is secure because Jesus got up and rose from the dead. Paul said in 1 Corinthians 15, 21 and 22, "For since death came through a man, the resurrection of the dead also comes through a man. For just as in Adam all die, so also in Christ," here it is, "all will be made alive." We just celebrated this baptism, and we think about what baptism symbolizes, just for clarity for those who are new. Again, I always have to remember how it was when I first went to church, having never grown up in church, not knowing the Bible, when I saw the first baptisms, and there wasn't a lot of explanation going on back then. There was just an assumption that if you were in church, you understood all of the church lingo, right? Sanctification and propitiation and atonement and baptism and all these words that are exclusive to the church. So let me just explain to you, the baptism waters have nothing to do with purchasing your salvation. The baptism waters are something that happens after you have surrendered your heart and life to Jesus. And when you go down in that water the same way Jesus did, you are signifying that you are dying to your old way of life. And then when you come up out of that water, you are signifying, symbolizing that you are born again in Christ, that you have an entirely new life in Christ. And so we realize that our future is secure because Jesus walked out of the dead. And when you get baptized, you're saying, I'm going public with this private faith, I've committed my life to Jesus, but listen, I want the world to know, because Paul said, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation for those that believe. Listen, our future is secure. Jesus suffered this brutal death as an innocent man so that you and I, everyone listening in this room, everyone watching online, everyone who may never hear this message, so that you and I could be forgiven, but the grave couldn't hold him. Yes, he died. Why do we call it Good Friday? Because the payment for our sins, the debt that we could not pay ourselves, was paid on that Good Friday when he shed his blood. Oh, but Satan thought he won. He had a couple days to turn up at the club and be like, we got him. But Sunday came. And on Sunday morning, the ground began to shake and the stone was rolled away. And Jesus, I don't believe Jesus moseyed out. Because Jesus had a sense of humor. All you got to do is read the Gospels. But I believe he strutted out. He might have had a little limp with it, you know. I don't know how he walked out. Maybe he was just straightening up a little bit. But whatever the case, he walked out of that tomb with full authority because Satan was finally defeated once and for all. So listen, as they come to play, I told you I wasn't going to tarry long today. I think we just need to get to it. So listen, our future and the promise of an eternal inheritance with our Heavenly Father, it hinged upon Jesus rising from the dead. Everything hinged on that resurrection Sunday morning. And guess what? He did. He got up. He rose from the dead. The thing about Jesus, I said he's a promise keeper earlier. I said our hope is secure because of the promises that Jesus makes. He keeps his promises. You know what? Jesus made some promises. He made a lot of promises, but let me just tell you four that I believe are important for us today to marinate on. Jesus made these promises. First, he said that he would suffer and be crucified, and he was. You remember Peter tried to stop it. Jesus started talking about his impending death, and Peter said, no, Lord, I'm never going to let you do that. You ever had that one friend that they always got something to say, like, you know, that was Peter. It's like sometimes he got it. When they said, who do people say that I am? Peter said, you know, other people said, some say you're John, some say whatever. Like Elijah, he said, you are the Son of the living God. You are the Messiah. So he got it right there. But then when Jesus tells him what he came to do, that I got to go to the cross. I got to pay the price for everyone's sins. Peter said, I'm not going to let that happen. And Jesus rebuked him, right? We know that statement, get behind me, Satan. He wasn't calling him Satan, but the spirit of Satan that was influencing him in that moment. He was trying to get in the way of what God was trying to do. Jesus had made a promise that he was going to suffer and go to the cross and be crucified, and he fulfilled that promise. On Good Friday, I preached a simple three-word message, it is finished. Jesus made the promise that it is finished, and he fulfilled that promise. His blood was sufficient to pay the price for your sins, for my sins, for the sins of all who would call on his name. Jesus said he would rise on the third day, and he kept that promise. The final promise. Are you listening, church? He said he's coming back. He says no one knows the day or the hour. He said when it happens, it's going to happen like a thief in the night. It's going to happen suddenly when you're least expecting it. But if he kept these other three promises, how many of y'all know he's going to keep that fourth promise? He's coming back. The disciples thought he was gone when he went to that tomb, but he came back for the moment. But then he went to be with his Heavenly Father, and he said, I'm coming back, and you all know where I'm going. He said, Lord, we don't know where we're going. How can we know the way? Jesus responded, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father but through me. Jesus is the only gateway, hear me. There is no other way to get to heaven. There's no other way to experience the hope that is alive, the future that is secure, the faith that is validated, apart from Jesus Christ. He is the only way. And he said he's coming back again. So the big question for you today, this morning, is are you ready for when he comes back? Because he's going to fulfill that promise. And that is our living hope. That he's going to crack that sky one day in the same way it says he went, he's coming back. The dead in Christ will rise first and meet him in the air, and those who are alive and remain will also rise. And when we get to go be with him, that's a one and done. We're never going to leave that place. We're going to be with him for all the rest of eternity. But the question you're posed with this morning is, are you ready for Jesus' return? If you can't say beyond a shadow of a doubt, I want to tell you a scripture that you may or may not be familiar with. The Bible says, it insinuates that you don't have to wonder about your salvation. It says these words, that you can know that you are saved. And the beautiful thing about it is Jesus did all the heavy lifting. He did all the hard work. He got beaten. He went to the cross. He died and he was resurrected. He did all the work. And the Bible simply says this, that those who call on the name of the Lord will be saved. But I want to caution you this morning. I'm not a fan of easy believism. It is easy. Jesus did all the hard work. What I mean when I say easy believism is I can come to Jesus with no expectations, that I don't have to yield to any expectations that he has of me. There is a commitment. The Bible says, you see these pillars on either side of the stage that say embrace the cross. A couple years ago, that was our annual theme, and I just haven't been able to let go of it because Jesus said, if anyone wishes to follow me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me daily. Well, we've already established the cross is an instrument of death. It means I have to die to my old way of life. I have to die to my way. I have to be willing to embrace the cross and follow Jesus daily. There are some expectations. That's not what saves you, but that is the evidence that you have made a genuine commitment to the Lord. So my question to you today is, are you ready for the return of Jesus? And if not, you now have all the tools that you need to understand who Jesus is, how we know that he resurrected, and what that means for us. And so the Bible says that if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. So I'm going to pray. And I would encourage you, if you've never done that, or you say, maybe I've been in church my whole life and I'm realizing at this very moment that I have never come to a place where I acknowledged that I'm a sinner desperately in need of salvation. And that salvation can only come through Jesus. You've never asked God to forgive you for your sins and then put your trust in saying, Jesus, save me. I cannot save myself. I'm asking you to come in and be the Savior and the Lord of my life. I'm committing to follow you. I'm committing to embracing the cross. If you've never done that, while I pray, I would encourage you to pray right where you're at, even if you're watching online. As I've already cautioned, reciting words is simply reciting words. You know, somebody said one time, the distance between heaven and hell is about 18 inches. And I thought, what? When I heard that the first time. And then they paused for effect, I guess. And they said, that's about the distance between here and here. You can know all about Jesus up here. You can say all the right things up here. But until it drops down into here, and you say, listen, beyond knowledge, this is what I believe, and I'm putting my faith in Jesus to save me. And if that's you this morning, I would just encourage you to pray something along those lines. If you mean it and you're ready, you say, Pastor, I want to give my life to Jesus today. I need to make this commitment. I want to be ready when Jesus returns. But more importantly, I want to live for him now while I'm still here on earth. You pray something along these lines. You can put it in your own words. You can pray it out loud. Or I'm not asking you to bow your head. If you want to close your eyes, you can. But, you know, I don't really think they did that. There's no record of them doing that. I mean, when Peter got up and preached the gospel at Pentecost, it says 3,000 people got saved that day, but there was no mention of bowing heads. And I do that sometimes. I do that so that people aren't distracted. And if that's what you need to do, then do it. But more importantly, it's about the posture of your heart right now. So you would say something like this, Lord Jesus, I acknowledge that I am a sinner in need of a Savior. I cannot save myself. I cannot earn it. I certainly cannot buy it. It can only come through Jesus Christ. So today, Lord, I call on the name of Jesus to save me. I ask you to forgive me for my sins. I ask you to adopt me into your family as a child of God on this Resurrection Sunday, 2024. Thank you, Jesus, for saving me. I commit my life to you from this day forward. Now, the Bible says that if you meant that down here, that if you meant it beyond just a head knowledge, remember, the Pharisees had a lot of head knowledge, the religious people of Jesus' day. In fact, let me just paint a picture really quick before I close. Jesus said these words, and this is a good wake-up call for the church, particularly here in America. Jesus said, many, say many. He said, many people will come to me in that day, the day of judgment, and they will say these words, Lord, Lord. Not once, but twice they will address Jesus as Lord, signifying that they're now acknowledging that he is Lord. Lord, Lord, did I not prophesy in your name, Jesus? Didn't I do miracles in your name, Jesus? Didn't I even cast out demons in your name, Jesus? Now, if we saw all that, we would say that person is a Christian. And Jesus said, depart from me, I never knew you, you that work iniquity. So that even goes to show us that just because somebody can be charismatic and do signs and wonders, that they're operating under a spirit for sure, but it's not the Holy Spirit. If we think Satan is not operating spiritually through people to deceive people from knowing the true Jesus and surrendering their life to Jesus, then we are the ones that are greatly deceived. So let's not be those people that show up and stand before Jesus and say, come on, Jesus, I went to church. I sang in the choir. I mean, I served at the Easter extravaganza. I was out there sweating for Jesus. Jesus says, I don't know you. S.M. Lockridge says, I wonder, do you know him? I wonder. That's my king. I wonder, do you know him? Well, just marinate on that today as I pray and close us out. For those who are already saved, I hope you've been encouraged today of what the implications of the cross and the resurrection mean to us. Let me pray. Father, I'm so thankful for this church family. I'm so thankful to get to serve alongside them, and I'm thankful for all of our guests today and those we got to connect with yesterday through our Easter extravaganza. Father, we do all of this because we so desperately want people to know your Son, the Savior of the world, the one who is a living hope, the one who guarantees our future, that it is secure. Father, that the one who validated our faith by walking out of that tomb on that resurrection Sunday. Today, if there's anyone, God, who called on the name of Jesus, who genuinely meant that, Father, I pray that today you would secure that in them, that you, through the power of your Holy Spirit, you would let them know at this very moment that it is real, that you are real, that you have imparted your Holy Spirit into their life, God, to live in them, to lead them, to guide them. But God, I pray that they would get connected, whether that's here at Renew Church or whether that's somewhere else. I pray they would connect with a faith family so they can begin to grow and be discipled of what it means to walk with you and live for you. Father, for those that are walking with you today, God, we thank you for the encouragement that is found in your word. There's so many more implications of the resurrection, God, but for these three promises, that our faith has been validated, that our future is secure. Father, we just thank you for that. And today we lift up the name of Jesus. As Paul wrote to those Christians there in Philippi, the name that is Jesus was highly exalted and given the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. So it is in that name that we worship you today, that we celebrate the resurrection, and it is in that name that we pray. And the church said, amen, amen. Come on, let's thank the Lord for the worship today and the baptisms and just all that God is doing. Listen, I want to just extend an invite to you. Listen, if you don't have a church home, we definitely don't go fishing in other people's ponds, you know. If you have a church home that you're committed to, then praise the Lord. But if you don't have a church home, we would love to have you journey with us. Many of you that are guests, and I found this out yesterday, did not realize that Renew Church is only 6 years old. Florida Boulevard Baptist Church met on this property since the 1950s, and back in 2019, they voted to merge with Renew Church and gift us this property. And so even though we were just barely a fledgling congregation, not even 2 years old yet, this became our permanent home, and several of those members stayed and are still journeying with us today. You saw some of them on the platform today and in the foyers, and so we're excited about what God is doing in this first 6 years, and as we grow, our heart is to transform our city for the glory of God. So if you feel like you need a church home, we want to invite you to continue to come back. We have this thing called Try Five. Just give us 5 Sundays, and then we feel like it takes that long to really get a feel whether or not this is a church that you could plug in with. So So we're happy you're here today. Don't forget your first-time guest gifts on the way out. I'll have some help back there. My wife's already exited, so I'll be with her in a moment. Don't forget to turn in your Connect card or scan the code on the Connect card and do it online. It's very simple. It just gives us a record of your attendance. But if you want to stay in the loop about all that we're doing in our community and you want to get involved, that's why you want to give us that email and phone number there, and then that way we can email you the happenings at Renew Church. With that said, we do have, I almost forgot. We're starting a new sermon series next week, and I am pumped, all right? It came down to the wire, and I wasn't sure where the Lord was leading me, but I want you to take a look at this brief video, just about 25-second video. This is the sermon bumper for our new series that starts next Sunday. Take a look at this. Yeah. Well, y'all aren't as excited as I am, but I'm excited to preach the Sermon on the Mount. Jesus, I think the most powerful sermon has ever been preached, Matthew chapter 5 through 7, just three chapters in the Bible where Jesus gave this long sermon and what I have titled now, Winning at Life. You want to learn how to win at life? Jesus had a lot to say about it. We saw all these things that people quantify what they think winning at life is, and in just a few weeks, we're going to be able to put at LSU women's basketball to that as well. But with that said, join us starting next Sunday for our new sermon series, Winning at Life, and then with that said, there is one closing video, our actual video announcements, that's going to give you everything else you need to know about what's happening at Renew. As soon as this next video ends, you're officially dismissed.
Good morning, and welcome to Renew Church. My name is Jasmine. Whether you're in the building or have joined us online, we are so blessed that you chose to worship with us today. If you're a first-time guest, please make sure to head to the foyer after service where you can exchange your Connect card for a first-time guest gift. We would also ask that everyone turn in their Connect card to an usher on your way out. If you joined us online, please fill out an online Connect card found on our website at renewchurchonline.org so that we know you worship with us. And please, don't forget to share your prayer requests and your praise reports.
Oftentimes in life, we run into challenges and obstacles, and no one should have to go through that alone. That's why we have Connect Groups at Renew Church. A Connect Group is a small group of people who get together weekly to do life together and grow in their relationship with the Lord. If you're not in a Connect Group, we want to encourage you to pray about joining one. For more information about group times and locations, you can call the church office at 225-272-3740.
Hey, Renew Church family, Pastor Checkerz here. We are excited because we have an opportunity to engage our city with the gospel. And so I'm here with my friend Daryl, and in just a moment, he's going to tell you about a great event that's coming up. But we don't want to just show up at this event. We want to be prepared for this event. So we're offering another evangelism training that he's going to facilitate on April the 6th. And I'm going to let him tell you a little bit more about that as well as the event. So Daryl, tell him what's going to be happening.
Listen to me. April 27 and 28, outside of Memorial Stadium, we're holding a big gospel fest called the Lit Fest. Yes, you heard me right. The Lit Fest. It's going to be amazing. We're going to have bounce houses. We're going to have train rides. We're going to have a mountain climbing wall, vendors, food trucks. It's going to be absolutely amazing. But this is the thing. The best part about it is we're going to preach the gospel, and many people are going to come and get saved. It's going to be amazing. You don't want to miss it.
Yeah, and so where we come in is they're going to need to connect those people who respond to the gospel to a local church, and we want to be there in full effect. We're going to train you, equip you, and be ready through our evangelism training on April 6th here at the church, and you're going to see details about that on our website as well as in a bulletin. So register for that. We're going to equip you and prepare you so that we can help these folks who respond to the gospel get connected to the church. You don't want to miss it. Stay tuned for the details in the bulletin and on our website, and we are excited about how God is going to reach and transform lives in our city.
Hey, ladies. Saturday, April 13th, we will be having our next Women's Fellowship. It'll be a brunch-style gathering. You're invited to join us here at the church from 10 a.m. to 12 p.m. for an amazing time of fellowship, prayer, and Bible study. We look forward to seeing you there.
Kids Mega Sports Camp is back. We're excited to announce that we are hosting our annual Kids Mega Sports Camp from Thursday, June 6th to Sunday, June 9th. We need plenty of volunteers to help with our sports drills, cheerleading, registration, setup, food team, and more. You do not have to be athletic to serve at this camp. There's a place for everyone. Be sure to sign up by scanning the QR code or completing the form found on your bulletin shelf.
Mark your calendars, because our next Discover Renew Luncheon is Sunday, April 14th, immediately following our Sunday morning worship service. If you're new to Renew Church or have never attended our Discover Renew Luncheon, we want to invite you to join us for this free luncheon where you will learn about the vision, values, and beliefs of Renew Church, as well as how to become a member. You can RSVP by writing luncheon on your Connect card and handing it to an usher on your way out today. RSVPs are appreciated, but not required. So we hope you'll join us Sunday, April 14th, for this free luncheon.
If you've missed any of our previous sermons or series, you can watch them on our website at renewchurchonline.org. And you can also download the sermon notes.
Thank you for joining us here at Renew Church, and we pray that you have a blessed day.